from ABC News. A television event. 100 years in the making. The century.
February 1933, Miami, Florida. 2 weeks before his inauguration, the president-elect was perched on the backseat of his car, talking to a crowd of supporters. Here's how the newsreels reported it then.
Somewhere in that throng, a killer lies waiting to hurl death into the Florida dust. Suddenly, shots ring out.
It was a bystander's quick thinking that saved Franklin Roosevelt's life.
I knew he was shooting at the president, so I take my right arm and pushed the pistol up just as hard as I could.
The bullet struck the mayor of Chicago. The president-elect held the mayor in his arms as they rushed to the hospital. "Don't talk," said Roosevelt. "It won't hurt if you don't talk." But the mayor was mortally wounded. The assassin went to the electric chair. Mr. Roosevelt went to the White House. 14 years later, the same newsreels which had chronicled Roosevelt's election were part of an industry under attack.
Fear does terrible things.
Are you now, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
The fear of communism had spread across the country and infected Hollywood.
By 1950, a Roosevelt Democrat would have been called a communist.
Were there communist messages in the movies? The search for an enemy that divided America.
Tonight on The Century, Coming Apart.
Good evening and welcome once more to The Century. I'm Peter Jennings. In tonight's episode, we're going to look at two moments in the 20th century when the very fabric of America seemed to be coming apart. Until the late 1920s, Americans had generally held that capitalism was a self-correcting system that didn't need government intervention. Then came the misery of the Great Depression. And as we see in our first hour, the desperate, some argued, un-American measures adopted to fight it. Until the late 1940s, Americans had seen Hollywood as a symbol of cultural pride, the epicenter of the nation's entertainment industry. Then came the Cold War, and as we see in our second hour, the fear that the nation's dream factories could be used to advance the cause of communism. Tonight, two stories of danger and suspicion. In 1933, America was facing the gravest threat to its survival since the Civil War. It was a calamity that Americans thought impossible. But America's capitalist economy had simply stopped working. So many banks had failed that 9 million people had their savings wiped out. One out of every four Americans had no income at all. There was so much resentment of the establishment that it was spilling over into violence. Destitute veterans of World War I who'd risked their lives for freedom were met with tear gas when they took their grievances to Washington. Some Americans, convinced that capitalism was dead, were marching in the name of communism. This was a worldwide depression. And in Germany, it helped to make Adolf Hitler possible. In America, there were fears that democracy might not survive. In 1933, 34 days after Hitler became Chancellor of Germany, Franklin Roosevelt became President of the United States. Between the election in November and his inauguration in March, he had said almost nothing about his plans for the country, a country that was falling apart. On Inauguration Day, March the 4th, 1933, America was in the midst of the worst financial panic in its history. Americans everywhere had lost faith in the banks and were desperately trying to get their money out.
There is a sense of fear developing in the country, a fear about whether our institutions were going to survive.
The American economy seemed to be in the final stages of self-destruction.
On the morning of Roosevelt's inauguration, Richard Whitney, the head of the New York Stock Exchange, steps to the rostrum to sound the gong to let the trading begin. And instead he announces, the stock market is closing down. That same day, one state after another closed its banks. So by the time Roosevelt takes office, the stock market is closed down. Most of the banks in the country have closed their doors, and all eyes are turned toward Washington.
All eyes are turned towards Roosevelt. He moved awkwardly down the steps of the Capitol front to be sworn in. Millions of Americans had no idea that he wore heavy leg braces because of polio. That to move like this, supported by his son, required a massive will. People didn't know much about Roosevelt. He came from a famous family, he had money, and he had been governor of New York. But he'd been elected almost as an act of desperation. President Hoover had done so badly.
This is preeminently the time to speak the truth, the whole truth, frankly and boldly. Nor need we shrink from honestly facing conditions in our country today. This great nation will endure as it has endured, will revive and will prosper. I shall ask the Congress for the one remaining instrument to meet the crisis, broad executive power to wage a war against the emergency as great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe.
Roosevelt had, from day one, an extraordinary gift. When he spoke to people, they believed him, and he gave them courage. Americans across the country listening on the radio were so moved by his inaugural speech that 450,000 of them wrote him letters. Farmers, workers, and businessmen, black and white, from every section of the country.
Roosevelt's White House had to hire a staff of 70 people to handle this volume of mail that ordinary citizens would write on lined paper and butcher paper and fractured grammar and poor spelling and all the rest of it. But ordinary people felt this sense of intimate connection with the person of Franklin Roosevelt. It was quite extraordinary.
Roosevelt moved into office like a whirlwind. On his second day in office, he ordered all the nation's banks to close for 4 days. He called Congress into emergency session. And within a week, he produced a bank reform bill. After only 38 minutes of debate, the House of Representatives passed it without even reading it. And then Roosevelt took to the radio to convince Americans that the banks could now be trusted.
My friends, I want to talk for a few minutes with the people of the United States about banking. I want to tell you what has been done in the last few days and why it was done and what the next steps are going to be. We have provided the machinery to restore our financial system, and it is up to you to support and make it work.
When the banks reopen, so great is the sense of confidence that Roosevelt has instilled in the country that deposits exceed withdrawals, and the crisis is over.
The banking crisis was over. Now Roosevelt faced an even tougher challenge, leading the nation to a full economic recovery. During an extraordinary session of Congress that lasted 100 days, Roosevelt pushed through a set of ambitious new laws that provided jobs for the unemployed, food for the hungry, higher prices for business. Roosevelt called it the New Deal and promised there would be something for everyone. The president thought that healing the economy would heal the nation.
That is the road to economic safety. And I ask you to choose that road.
This meant a bigger and more powerful federal government. Roosevelt pushed the government to do things it had never done before, to take strong measures to revive the economy. He called them experiments and acknowledged that they might fail. But to get the economy moving again, Roosevelt would try anything.
He likened himself to a quarterback. A quarterback calls a play. If that play doesn't work, then you try another play. But you keep on calling the plays.
In the spring and summer of 1933, Roosevelt's experiments enjoyed nearly universal support. Americans welcomed the vigor and energy that Washington now radiated. It seemed that even the Depression would somehow yield to Roosevelt's charisma.
Confidence! And lick this old depression! Confidence! And wear the right expression! Teach it! Preach it! Count it! Shout it! Confidence! Just have confidence!
There was only one thing wrong. It didn't work. Throughout the president's first term in office, the high expectations of 1933 went largely unfulfilled. For every success Roosevelt achieved, he reaped an equal measure of failure. And as you'll see, it was not long before his experiments were dividing the nation.
The Century, brought to you by the rugged Montana from Pontiac. Life is more exciting in Montana. And First Union, your guide to the financial world.
The Century continues. Here again, Peter Jennings.
President Roosevelt was regarded by the great majority of Americans as a man who understood their pain. During his first year in office, he got more than 2 million letters from people who believed that he could and he would use his power, the power of government, to help them. The problem was that out there in the country, where people were desperate for jobs, not everyone played fair.
Dear Mr. President, The way they work people is awful. When I came out of the mill down here last Friday evening, I'd worked so hard till I felt like I was nearer dead than I was living. I wondered if I would ever get home. Seemed to me like every step would be the last one. I couldn't even walk straight. I had worked so hard till I just staggered like a drunk man. And I wasn't the only girl that come out of the mill in that condition, neither. Belle Seymour.
To the men and women who worked in American industry, the Depression had dealt a staggering blow. Since 1929, 40% of all manufacturing workers had been laid off. Those who still had jobs would do almost anything to keep them.
The industrial workplace was very, very different than what it is today. It was dangerous, it was precarious, it was insecure, it was despotic. People had to work endless hours. They were subjected to constant speed up. They were fired if they protested. There's an enormous growing sense on the part of millions of Americans that America is no longer a fair and just society.
To those who owned the nation's industries, the issue was simple economics. Because of the Depression, business income had collapsed, and owners saw no alternative but to cut wages and lay people off. Roosevelt thought he had the answer. A way to get people back on the job and get business income back up again. It was the National Recovery Administration, the NRA.
The NRA's Blue Eagle is born, and the nation's workers marched in the greatest peacetime parade of U.S. history.
The NRA was unprecedented. It put the federal government in the controversial position of controlling prices and wages. The president launched a massive public relations campaign to encourage compliance.
That is why I am asking the employers of the nation to sign this common covenant with me, to sign it in the name of patriotism and in the name of humanity. That is why I am asking the workers of America to go along with us in a spirit of understanding and of helpfulness.
Roosevelt expected management and labor to put aside their differences, but their divisions were far deeper than he understood. His plan to bring peace instead led to conflict, much of it set in motion by one small paragraph of the NRA law, Section 7A.
It was a sort of footnote to the bill. I don't think that Roosevelt himself was prepared for the kind of uprising that Section 7A, giving workers the right to organize, was going to lead to.
Section 7A was a milestone in American labor history because it seemed to say that the President of the United States was endorsing the organization of unions.
Section 7A, for the first time, established the legal right to join unions. Suddenly, workers everywhere were organizing and demanding better treatment from their bosses. In spite of the NRA, many factory owners were determined to resist.
In 1930s America, the gloves were off. Corporate America deployed the most vicious, violent series of tactics. They stockpiled munitions for their private police and private armies who were prepared to beat and shoot workers who engaged in organizing efforts. The history of American labor in the 1930s is a very bloody history.
In 1934, there was a wave of violent strikes. In Minneapolis, teachers had petitioned and tried to shut down business in the city. The communist-led longshoremen tried to shut down the port of San Francisco. In both cities, after bloody battles with police and even the National Guard, both unions won their demands. This was not what President Roosevelt had in mind.
Roosevelt, in general, was opposed to strikes, whether they were radical or not, because he thought that they were interfering with the success of his recovery program.
Roosevelt had never really established a strong affinity for the labor movement. He felt more comfortable as a kind of gentry paternalist, expressing his sentiments for the helpless, but not for those who might, after all, exercise power in their own right, that is, an organized labor movement.
Section 7A had a particularly powerful effect on America's textile workers. In just 1 year, the United Textile Workers Union enrolled more than 200,000 new members. Conditions in the textile mills had long been oppressive. The mills were noisy and dark and dangerous. Wages were low. The work was relentless, 6 days a week, 12 hours a day. But in June 1933, it seemed conditions were about to improve. The textile industry agreed to abide by a code of conduct to be enforced by the NRA. The owners would get higher prices. In return, they would limit working hours and raise wages. At first, the mill hands were very happy. Under the new code, they would get a pay raise, a 5-day week, and an 8-hour day. Before long, however, the owners began to bend the rules.
What happened was the owners began to take away with one hand what they had given with the other. The workers call this code chiseling, and it consisted mainly of forcing workers to do as much work in 8 hours as they had done in 12.
We call it the stretch yard because it is a system of adding machine after machine per worker until their minds crack and their bodies give way.
Under the code that the owners had agreed to, unfair workloads were expressly prohibited. The workers, who believed that Roosevelt would understand, complained to the NRA. But under the NRA's rules, all complaints were sent back to the owners for investigation. In a 1-year period, nearly 4,000 complaints were filed and only one was resolved in a worker's favor. Frustrated workers appealed directly to the president.
We're being worked so hard until we just cannot stand the strain. The people are tired of being knocked around and treated like dogs. If ain't something done at once, it's going to be war.
On September the 1st, 1934, the Textile Workers Union led the biggest strike in American history. It involved 400,000 workers from Maine to Alabama. It affected hundreds of mills. Various governors called out the National Guard to prevent the picketers from closing the mills down. In Georgia, the governor had strikers rounded up and held in a detention camp. German prisoners had been held there during World War I.
It was an extremely volatile situation. People were, on both sides, were terrified and they were armed. And it was a disaster waiting to happen.
I always blow the early morning whistle, you know. Said it was a wake-up whistle. Well, they blowed and blowed and blowed that whistle. I don't know whether it was to warn the people what to do or what, but that was the day that it happened.
The worst violence took place in the small South Carolina mill town of Honeypath. Almost everyone worked at the Chicola Mill, which was determined to break the strike. The company had all the power in town, and only half the workers were in the union. Early on the morning of September the 6th, a crowd of several hundred gathered at the mill. There were armed policemen outside. Inside the mill, the company superintendent, Dan Beecham, who was also the town's mayor, deputized dozens of non-union workers, and many had guns.
It was neighbor against neighbor. And people who worked beside each other in the mill that had been friends for years, some were on the inside, some were on the outside.
At the gate, the strikers formed a picket line. A scuffle broke out with the local police. Shots were fired. A worker named Lee Crawford was one of the first to fall.
And then that's when Daddy went back to try to help Uncle Lee. And then they shot Daddy. A lot of the witnesses and everything said both of them was crawling, trying to get up, and they were shot in the back again.
Seconds later, there were more shots fired from the mill windows. The firing lasted for more than a minute.
My brother-in-law was shot in the back as he went down the street to go to his brother-in-law's house. He wasn't but about two houses from it when he fell. You know, things like that's hard to forget.
When the shooting stopped, 6 men were dead.
Mother always said they was laying side by side. She picked them up and she picked the grass out of their mouth. She did Dad, and then she went to Uncle Lee. One of the officers come by and told her if she didn't leave, they'd kill her. Another one stepped up and says, no, you won't. There's been enough killing here already.
The dead workers were mourned as martyrs. Their funeral attracted 10,000 people from all over the country. It was a milestone in the history of American labor.
The people who were on strike at the mill went in to win. They absolutely thought they would win this because they had Roosevelt behind them. They had the New Deal, the NRA. Everything was in behind them. They thought the government wanted them to organize. They never had any idea. I'm sure they never had any idea that they were going to lose their life when they went to the mill that morning.
Dear Mr. President, in Honeyah Pass, South Carolina, there were 6 people killed and more than a score injured this morning. I ask you, the leader of our great nation, to halt the still operating industries and prevent any further bloodshed until an agreement can be reached. Trusting in you to lead us out of this and praying for you to be directed by the Almighty God, I am yours respectfully, Mrs. Dottie Henry.
2 weeks later, Roosevelt's aides worked out a settlement. The union would call off the strike, and the strikers would get their jobs back. Instead, almost all of them were fired.
We tried to return to our jobs, but Mr. McKelvey said before he would work the union help, he would close the mill down, that you might run the U.S., but he was going to run the Loray Mill. I've tried over 300 cotton mills for work, and they will not hire me because I belong to the union. There is starvation ahead if I don't get work at once. Please, for God's sake, help me get work.
Explore an America struggling to survive on thecentury.com.
The Century, Coming Apart, will continue after this from our ABC stations. The Century, Coming Apart, continues.
On the farmlands of America, the Depression was destroying a way of life that had flourished for generations. The prices of farm products had fallen to their lowest level in decades. Hundreds of thousands of farmers were losing money and falling ever more deeply into debt. By 1933, when Roosevelt took office, farmers were desperate and starting to organize. In the Midwest, they staged violent demonstrations. They blockaded highways, they invaded capitals, and they threatened a national farm strike.
They've driven me out here to do what we're doing. I can't keep my family and live like a man should live. And there's two things that'll make a man or beast fight: hunger and protection of your offspring.
Farmers everywhere were demanding action from Washington.
It worried Roosevelt greatly that if something wasn't done swiftly and dramatically to remedy the situation in the countryside, there might very well be revolution in rural districts.
The issue that created the most desperation was foreclosure. With no money to pay their mortgages, thousands of families were losing their farms.
It just devastated them, whole families. You can imagine, here's your home. It's not only your business, but your home.
The threat or the fear of losing one's farm is the most serious emotional and economic crisis of the Great Depression, and it's what creates so much of the fear, so much of the militancy.
On April the 27th, 1933, just weeks after President Roosevelt's inauguration, farmers in Lamar's, Iowa, infuriated by a wave of foreclosures, invaded the local courthouse. The judge, Charles Bradley, had signed dozens of foreclosure orders. The crowd demanded an end to it. The judge refused. And so they dragged him off his bench and took him to the edge of town, where they threatened to hang him if he didn't agree to their demands.
And as one of them told me, one of the things they did was pull down his pants and fill them with mud, threaten him with castration, and they got a truck hubcap and put it on his head so the grease ran down over his face.
One farmer grabs a long piece of rope and they make it into a noose. And they threaten to hang him. Here are these Republican Protestant Iowans. They are threatening to hang a sitting judge.
Finally, one man begged the crowd not to do it, and the judge was released, though they did leave him beaten up and bleeding by the side of the road. The very next day, the governor of Iowa declared martial law. The Bradley episode hit Washington like a shockwave. There was a real fear that a rural revolution might begin.
The insurgency of farmers helped to quicken the feeling in Washington that something had better be done and be done right away.
In Washington, everyone agreed that farm prices were low because of a huge surplus of farm products. Once again, President Roosevelt was determined that the federal government should intervene. He engineered a formula unlike any the country had ever seen. The Agricultural Adjustment Act of 1933 was designed to raise the price of farm products by reducing the surplus. Farmers were paid to destroy millions of unsold pigs and to plow under 10 million acres of crops they'd already planted. The president's farm bill seemed to contradict the basic nature of farming. It actually paid farmers to produce less. It was a very sharp break with the traditions of the land.
Many farmers were deeply offended at the idea of curtailing production. This was unknown to them. It seemed contradictory. It violated this basic sense of what a farmer existed for.
And as far as some of the president's critics were concerned, as bad as times were, it violated the American way of life. More Bolshevistic than any regulation in Soviet Russia, said one Republican congressman. No one thought at the time that this dramatic intrusion by the government in yet another aspect of life would last until the 1990s. In the depths of the Depression, most farmers were just grateful for a chance to survive. The Vogel family in Stewart, Nebraska, was about to lose its farm.
Corn was worth 10 cents a bushel on the market then, and that wouldn't pay enough to stop this foreclosure. Somehow a government program came that we've learned about that brought the price up to 50 cents a bushel, and that money was enough to stop the foreclosure that fall. And we'll always remember how wonderful it was that someone helped us.
President Roosevelt identified with farmers. He admired their independence. But once again, as it had been with the textile workers and the unions, government involvement would lead to unintended consequences. In the southern states, when the cotton growers cut back their production, many black workers and sharecroppers were no longer needed, and so the plantation owners forced them to leave the land.
I think that the Roosevelt administration did not see the actual outcome until it happened, until they saw huge numbers of African Americans and some poor white sharecroppers on the roads, you know, going back and forth looking for a place to crop. Some left the South after being thrown off the land and moved to cities like Chicago and New York. They really had no choice.
In Washington, some officials proposed new regulations that might stop the evictions. But in the end, the Roosevelt administration decided not to intervene.
The New Deal was not an effort to bring social equality to America. It was an effort to save capitalism, to get people back to work, and to prime the economy. And for that reason, the legislation reflected the racial thinking of the day.
But Roosevelt, with his inspiring words, had raised expectations among black Americans. So many blacks appealed directly to the president for help. A letter from a man in Georgia.
Your Honor, sir, I am down now. The relief hasn't helped me in a month. I'm begging you, please, sir, for food. They're helping white, but not me, a poor colored man. I know you have the power to correct such matters if you will. Now, what's interesting about this letter is that it doesn't necessarily reveal an affinity with Franklin Roosevelt, a friendship. It reveals a belief that as president, he has the power to solve their problems and ought to.
Century continues.
April the 28th, 1935. After 2 years as president, Roosevelt was preparing to run again.
Fear is vanishing. Confidence is growing on every side.
We have survived all of the arduous burdens and the threatened dangers of a great economic calamity.
Roosevelt's words exuded confidence, but in the spring of 1935, despite all he had said and done, the economy was still in deep trouble. The unemployment rate was a staggering 20%. Now, as he looked toward re-election, Roosevelt faced mounting political attacks from those who were angry with his economic policies.
For a united campaign against New Deal policies.
His most powerful opponents were the leaders of business. In 1933, they had gone along with his National Recovery Administration, with all of its rules, in the hope that they would prosper. They had not. And now they attacked the growing tangle of government regulations as a threat to free enterprise. The businessmen were winning support even in the president's own party. Al Smith, who had been Roosevelt's mentor in New York politics, now said that Roosevelt's way was the communist way.
There can be only one capital, Washington or Moscow. There can be only one flag, the stars and stripes, or the red flag of the godless Union of the Soviet.
You get an increasing hostility to Roosevelt of the bitterest sort being expressed by the captains of industry in America. They call him a traitor to his class. They accuse him of trying to Sovietize America. They truly hate him.
And what did Roosevelt do with your fellow townsmen?
And Senator Huey Long of Louisiana, a demagogue if ever there was one, denounced Roosevelt with equal fervor for doing too little with government. Long eagerly promoted his own plan.
We propose that no family will have less than from $5,000 to $6,000 as a homestead, the things that it goes to make a home, and no family will have less than from $2,000 to $2,500 annual income on top of that.
According to Long, the cure for the Depression was simple. The rich had too much money. It should be taken away from them and given to the poor. Based on his share the wealth plan, Long developed a national following and boasted that he would be the next president of the United States.
Who then is the inflationist, Roosevelt or the National Union?
From Detroit came another voice preaching simple solutions. Father Charles Coughlin, the radio priest, blamed the Depression on a conspiracy by the bankers. Coughlin, who had 40 million listeners a week, called the president a betrayer and a liar.
And so, Mr. Roosevelt, who was very loquacious in 1933 about driving the money changers out of the temple, is now bent upon another policy. I think driving the workmen out of decent annual wages.
Both Coughlin and Long charged the president with neglecting the needs of farmers, workers, the elderly, and the poor.
Roosevelt's fear was that people like Charles Coughlin and Huey Long might siphon off enough votes from the Democratic Party as to split the working class or vote on the left and give the election to the Republican candidate. This was a very real concern.
Roosevelt's watched the Huey Long Share the Wealth campaign. He's watched the country drift left. And so he's shrewd and politic enough to realize that if he moves in that direction, then he breathes a new lease on life into his administration.
This work in behalf of human needs is an essential part.
And so in the summer of 1935, Roosevelt got Congress to pass his second New Deal, legislation to benefit Americans at the bottom of the economic ladder.
The understanding that we've got to build from the bottom up.
Roosevelt was now pursuing permanent reforms to reduce the class divisions in America.
It's about this time that Roosevelt begins to focus less on economic recovery and more on the long-term structural and institutional reforms that I think are his first interest. He once said to Francis Perkins, his Secretary of Labor, he said, "The thing I want to do is to create a country in which no one is left out." And I think that, as much as any single sentence, summarizes his general social vision.
In 1935, the president decided that labor unions could help achieve that social vision. He signed the Wagner Act, which gave unions the strong federal protection they had not received until now. It reflected Roosevelt's new understanding that workers were also consumers whose purchasing power could strengthen the economy.
The vision of the New Dealers includes as a central premise that capitalism could be saved and should be saved by redistributing the way the economic system distributed its wealth and income. And one critical way to do that was to support a strong, robust labor movement, giving the labor movement the chance to bargain forcefully for its fair share of what it was producing.
Supported by the Wagner Act, organized labor now had an historic opportunity to unionize America's biggest industries. Workers created a new union federation, the Committee on Industrial Organization, the CIO. The CIO sent organizers to steel mills, to rubber plants, and to car factories. The companies resisted, often violently. But this time, the workers really had Roosevelt on their side. And this time, they won.
Millions upon millions of workers come into the CIO. And those workers thereafter became some of the most handsomely compensated workers in the American scene. It's as a direct result of the passage of the Wagner Act and the CIO's organizing campaigns that many millions of industrial workers enter the middle class in the post-World War II era because of the gains effected in the middle of the decade of the 1930s.
The civilization of the past 100 years, with its startling industrial changes, has tended more and more to make life insecure.
And so, to protect Americans from some of the hazards of capitalism, President Roosevelt created his most far-reaching reform.
This Social Security measure...
Social Security would guarantee an income to the old, the sick, and the unemployed. It would be funded by taxes, paid equally by employers and employees.
The Social Security Act of 1935 is arguably the most important single piece of legislation of the 20th century. It created a sense of vested rights that the American people have in the national government and gave Americans a sense that government was a good thing.
These populist measures enabled the president to build political support among Americans who had been without significant influence in government. And now the White House took a greater interest in the rights of black Americans. In this, the president's wife was his most influential advisor. Eleanor Roosevelt urged her husband to take a strong stand against racial discrimination.
She spoke out against lynching. She wrote columns. She wrote articles. If her husband disagreed with her, she ran for her pen.
Eleanor Roosevelt was attacked on all sides because of the fact that she had this relationship and she cared about people of color and the poor. She went into places in the South and she would require that people of all races be accepted.
In the White House itself, Mrs. Roosevelt saw to it that black leaders were seen and heard by the president. By 1936, the Roosevelt administration was doing more to help black Americans than any administration before it. And Roosevelt's Democratic Party was openly courting black support. For decades, most blacks who could vote had supported the Republicans, the party of Lincoln.
In 1936, a black minister gave a prayer at the Democratic Convention. Some white congressmen walked out in horror. It was unprecedented. And so it says, for the first time, race is on the agenda. And Eleanor Roosevelt and Franklin Roosevelt put race on the national agenda.
And that was the beginning of a major party realignment in American history, where to this day, African Americans are much more inclined to vote Democratic. And it has everything to do with their perception that the Roosevelt administration was on the right road towards racial justice.
My friend.
The election campaign of 1936 was hard fought. Roosevelt was the issue. He was attacked by the Republicans, Father Coughlin, Al Smith, and the supporters of Huey Long.
Never before in all our history have these forces been so united against one candidate as they stand today. They are unanimous in their hate for me, and I welcome their hatred.
Roosevelt's strategy had paid off. Millions of Americans everywhere now look to the government, to Roosevelt's government, as their friend.
Roosevelt begins to develop a much more broadly based coalition, which is going to be the core of the Democratic Party, not only in 1936, but for generations to come.
On November the 3rd, 1936, the new coalition delivered 46 of the 48 states to Roosevelt. It was one of the biggest election victories in the country's history. The president took it as a mandate for a larger, more powerful, more compassionate federal government. Roosevelt's vision was the driving force in American politics for two generations.